Make it count, leave a mark, build a name for yourself. Dream your dreams, chase your heart above all else. Make the name a world remembers. But all an empty world can sell is empty dreams. I kinda lost in a lie, it was sent to me.
United Methodist Church's online worship service for the second week of Lent 2021. I'm Charlotte Worley, one of the lay servants here at Mount Carmel. On behalf of our parish, which includes Mount Carmel UMC, Newmarket UMC, and Fairview Chapel, I thank you for the blessing of your presence and for your participation in this time of worship. As we come humbly before our Lord to praise Him and to open our hearts to His Word, I invite you at this time to set aside any distractions, to take a deep, calming breath, and to center yourself for worship. May our time together today both renew your spirit and honor our Lord. Our next worship song is You Say.
Thank you.
Dear God, you say that I am loved, and you show it again and again. We are loved, and we thank you for that. We thank you for your creation, for your love, for your mercy, for your grace. Lord, this season of Lent reminds us of the brokenness of our world, and of the brokenness in each of us. In observing Lent, we come face to face with suffering and we confront sin. Yet in the midst of our brokenness and our weakness, the observation of Lent also reminds us of your strength and of your infinite mercy and grace. It reminds us of who Jesus is, your Son, the Messiah, our Savior. Father, we long to be closer to you, closer to Jesus. Create in each of us a clean heart, a humble heart, which loves you above all things. Forgive us anything we have done to sadden you, and also forgive us for all those things we have not done that would gladden you. Help us set our minds on divine things, thinking about you, speaking about you, giving you thanks and praise, always striving to overcome evil with good. Lord, allow your power to be so evident in our lives that others will recognize that it is you who is at work on our behalf. Help us be true followers of Christ, who is the way, the truth, and the life. We pray all of this in his precious name. Amen. And now please join me in the prayer that Jesus himself taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Today's scripture reading is from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 8, verses 27 through 38. Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi, and on the way, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they answered him, "John the Baptist, and others say Elijah, and still others, one of the prophets." He asked them, "But who do you say I am?" Peter answered him, "You are the Messiah." And he sternly ordered them not to tell anyone about him. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days, rise again. He said all of this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
So glad to see you today. God bless you. I appreciate Brother Randy and the praise band. They were awesome as usual. And Miss Charlotte for her leadership and worship and how beautifully she read this awesome passage of scripture where Peter pronounces that Jesus is the Messiah. So what I hope to do today is be led by the Holy Spirit to bring a message that will help us as we continue to move through Lent, that will allow us to really understand better than we may do already, what the true cost of discipleship is and how we can plug into that even more. So it starts out in verse 27. Jesus asks his disciples, "Who do people say I am?" And he gets some interesting responses. They say, well, some say you're John the Baptist. Some say you're Elijah. Some say you're one of the prophets. And the reason why I say these responses are interesting is because by this time, Jesus had been all around like the region of Galilee, all around the sea. He had been healing people. He had been casting out demons, performing exorcisms. He had been across the sea, calming storms. That brother had done some things which had blown people's minds. Crowds and multitudes were following him, trying to touch him and press in on him, looking for their miracles. But then when asked, well, who all these people say I am? Oh, you're just one of the young prophets. You're John the Baptist. You're Elijah. Maybe come back to life. And so I was perplexed. I'm like, after all that the crowds had witnessed and maybe even had experienced Jesus do for them, that's really who they thought he was? So then he asked his disciples, well, who do people say I am? Who do you say I am? And Peter answered on behalf of the disciples and said, well, you're the Messiah. You are Christ, Son of God. Now, when Peter said that, Peter hit the nail on the head. And then Jesus' reaction was, in my words, weird. Because after Peter said, well, you're the Messiah. And of course, Peter would know that. The disciples would know that because they had been with Jesus during all this time that Jesus had been out healing, casting out devils, taking authority over the wind and the waves and doing all that stuff. So they heard his teaching. And there would be times when Jesus would even pull the disciples aside privately and teach them stuff that the average bear in the crowd wouldn't even be able to hear. So it was no surprise that Peter recognized him as the Messiah. But then Jesus' response to Peter, the reason why I'm saying it was weird, is because he sternly ordered them, Jesus sternly ordered Peter and the disciples, don't tell nobody. Don't make that known. And I'm like, what? Why are you saying that? Your whole purpose is to come showing that the kingdom of God has come and that repentance and forgiveness and eternal life is available because you are here. So why is it when one of your own disciples pronounces that you're the Messiah, you sternly say, oh, can it? Don't tell nobody. It kind of seems counterintuitive to maybe the witness that he was trying to get out about himself. So, well, as a good old-fashioned Methodist, okay, I look old-fashioned, don't I? I turned to John Wesley. And John Wesley said a couple of things. John Wesley said, maybe Jesus told them, don't tell nobody, because maybe it wasn't time for him to die yet. There might have been more teaching and other things to do. And I've heard people say that before. John Wesley also said, maybe Jesus told them, don't tell nobody, because if the crowd would have understood Jesus to be their Messiah, their new king, it could have been something that would have sparked a revolt against the Roman Empire, and that Jesus actually might have been installed by them as some kind of earthly king, like, you know, King David was back on the throne out of a nationalistic fervor. Our Messiah has come. Let's go defeat the Romans and rule again. And so Jesus wasn't about that. So John Wesley said that could be one of the reasons. Or one of the reasons John Wesley said, I thought this was interesting. It could be because of the resurrection. Jesus knew that his resurrection would be such a divine, awesome, self-revealing thing for the people that once they saw him crucified in such a horrible way that he would be on a cross and then risen from the dead, they would say, oh my God, he really was Son of God. And then under that fervor and recognition through the power of the resurrection, folks could go out there and witness who Jesus was and do the ministry that Jesus had called them to. So those are three reasons John Wesley gives us as to why Jesus sternly ordered his disciples not to tell anyone who he was. So, but Peter did say he is the Messiah, while everybody else, they reported, said, well, you're just one of the prophets. Then Jesus goes on and tells them that he must suffer great things and that he would even be killed and that he would rise again. And he mentioned when he's going to suffer great things and be killed, he mentions by whom the suffering is going to come. He says the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes. So he's talking about the religious leaders of Judaism are going to cause his great suffering and cause him to be killed. And he even throws in there, rejected. They are going to reject me. You know me as Messiah. They will never get there. They're going to reject me, cause great suffering, and I'm going to be killed. When Jesus tells them that, Peter then looks at Jesus and says, oh, no. Not going to happen. We will not let that happen to you. You're not going to be killed. Whatever this suffering is, whatever they're going to try and do to you, we'll fight. No, it ain't happening. And Jesus looked at Peter and rebuked Peter and said, get thee behind me, Satan. You don't care about the things of God. Your mind is on earthly things, not on heavenly things. And I'm like, whoa, what just happened here? Hang on a second. Jesus asked them, who do people say I am? They said, well, you're one of the prophets, John the Baptist, Elijah. And then Peter says, but we know you as Christ, the Son of God. And then Jesus tells them, you know, upsetting news. I'm going to suffer. I'm going to be rejected. And I'm going to be killed at the hands of the elders, the scribes, and the chief priests. And Peter says, no, it's not going to happen. And the way that Mark words it, Miss Charlotte read it so beautifully, Peter rebuked Jesus. Matter of fact, Peter grabbed Jesus by the arm, took Jesus aside, and rebuked him for saying he would be rejected, he would be caused great suffering, and that he would be killed. And I'm like, well, hang on a second, Peter. Now I got a problem with you. One minute, you're calling Jesus the Messiah. He's Son of God. And then as soon as Messiah says something that's challenging for you, says something that's difficult for you, says something that may not fit in with whatever your earthly view of him is, you pull him aside and rebuke him, and tell him, no, not going to be the way you say. How can you, on this hand, say Jesus is Messiah, Son of God, and then on this hand, when the one you recognize as Messiah, Son of God, says something difficult for you to deal with, you then rebuke him? So Jesus says, hold up, stop. Get thee behind me with that noise, Satan. I'm trying to talk to you about heavenly stuff. And your mind is on earthly stuff. Jesus then goes on to say what the cost of discipleship really, really is. And this is where we will find our Lenten moment for the week. Jesus says, if you really want to be my disciple, if you really want to be my follower, then what you have to do is deny yourself, take up your cross, then you can follow me. And I heard Jesus say that. Okay, well, I wasn't really there that day, but, you know, as I read and studied. So I hear Jesus say that. I hear him say, you must first deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. And he goes on to say, because those who seek to save their life, well, they'll lose it. And those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel, they'll find their life again. So I hear Jesus say that, and I'm like, I'm starting to get what the heavenly thing is. See, in that setting where they were in that day, Jesus had told them that the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders were going to kill him. And now he's telling Peter and the rest of the crowd, he's saying, if you want to be my followers, recognize it's going to cost you your life. When you try to go out here in this world that's dominated by folks who are going to reject me, by folks who are not going to believe me, by folks who are going to turn me over to the Romans and be killed, you go out here speaking my name, you go out here carrying my mantle, the same thing is going to happen to you. And if you want to be my disciple, you then have to deny your own thoughts about this, your own reflections on this, and you're going to have to be willing to take that cross up and walk with me all the way. So the true cost of discipleship is this. 99.5 won't do. If you're going to give your life to Jesus Christ, you've got to be all in 100%. And that means if you're going to call Jesus Lord, confess your sins to him, ask him into your heart, and walk with him, then as soon as it gets difficult, or as soon as he leads you out of a comfort zone that you may be in and tells you to walk in new directions and take on new things and go in different ways, you can't say, oh, no, I ain't going to do that. You can't do a Peter satanic turnaround and rebuke Jesus the moment Jesus makes it a little tough, leading you in directions that aren't comfortable for you. If Jesus is Messiah, and if you're going to give him your life, then don't give him your life and turn around. Don't give him your life and go halfway. Don't give him your life and do 99%. It's going to cost you everything. Go with it. And Jesus says, here's what the payoff is. He says, if you lose your life for me, your life will be saved, because I'm coming back again in the glory of my Father and with the holy angels. And when I come in the glory of my Father and the holy angels, those of you who have denied yourself and followed me, even when it came to giving your life, then what's going to happen is I'll confess your name before my Father and the holy angels, and you'll walk with me wearing white in glory. But if you're ashamed of the things that I have to say right now, Peter, if you're ashamed of what I'm trying to tell you right now, if you're ashamed of my ministry and my work right now, if you don't see the heavenly purpose in what I'm doing right now, and you try to insert your fleshly view on me and not the will of the Father, then you're going to lose everything. So the key to true discipleship, the key to self-denial during this time of Lent where we deny ourselves through fasting and things like that, the key to true self-denial is to give your all to Jesus Christ. And once you pledge to give your all to Jesus Christ, do not turn around, even if Jesus leads you in places that may be out of your comfort zone, places that you don't expect, places that maybe even you can't even wrap your natural brain around. I mean, seek understanding, learn, grow, try to identify and get as much of Jesus Christ as you can, but don't stop and don't turn around. Give Jesus your all. And then when he comes back with his Father and the holy angels and the glory and all that good stuff, he will confess you before them, and you'll walk with him in white in his heavenly kingdom. So when I think about how we give stuff up for Lent, I look at this passage and Jesus says, first, deny yourself. And when Jesus said this, he didn't just say this to his disciples. He said this to the whole crowd. As a matter of fact, Mark says this. He called the crowd and the disciples to him and said, if anyone wants to be my follower, let him first deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. So the message about following Jesus through self-denial is a message not just for the disciples. It's a message for everybody. Like I said earlier, there were times when he called the disciples to himself and spoke to them privately. But this time he said this thing about discipleship to everybody. So that means the ways of heaven, the divine things that Jesus is bringing, the glory of God and in the power of the holy angels and all of that good stuff, all of that stuff is available to us if we are willing to deny ourselves the Peter mindset, where we don't want Jesus to speak anything that seems to be negative or unhappy or contrary. Jesus said, they're going to kill me. Matter of fact, the they is the people who should recognize me. I just asked you, who am I? And you said, I'm Son of God. Well, if you can say I'm Son of God, you've been walking with me and seeing the miracles and participating in them. What about the chief priests? What about the scribes? What about the elders who taught the traditions, who taught the prophets, who taught the law down through these centuries? They should know who I am. They're the very ones who are going to reject me. You can't fight me on this, Peter. This is going to happen. When I told God, I will follow your will, when I told my Father, I will obey your will, I came to earth and I went all the way straight to the cross. Now, if you're going to follow me like I follow the Father, then you got to go all the way wherever I lead you, and you can't turn around even if it gets uncomfortable for you. What does it profit you to gain the whole world and then lose your very own soul, lose your very own life, and never find eternal life in the end? So true discipleship, true self-denial, is not that in modern day America, we thank God for this. In modern day America, it won't cost us our life to be a Christian. You know, the Romans or the Jews aren't going to break through our doors and hunt us down and kill us. Thank God for that. So what does it mean in our context today of life, that we can give our all for Jesus Christ, that we can give our life for Jesus Christ? I'm glad you asked that question. And this is what real self-denial is. When it comes to giving your total, complete life to Jesus Christ, Jesus said these words in this passage. Set your mind not on earthly things. Set your mind on divine The scripture says, let the same mind that is in Christ Jesus also be in you. So if we're going to be followers of Jesus Christ, if we're going to carry out the work and function and ministry of Christ on this earth that he has given to us, that the Holy Spirit empowers us to do, then we have got to think like Jesus. We have to have our minds transformed by the Holy Spirit so we can see spiritual stuff, so we can tap into divine things and then be agents of the kingdom of God right here on earth. So get up out of your fleshy self, get up out of your old stuff, and walk in the newness of a transformed mind unto God, and begin thinking about divine things. Think about divine things as to when it comes to ministry, outreach, and service. Think about divine things when it comes to forgiving somebody. Think about divine things when it comes to loving somebody. Think about divine things when it comes to sacrificing for somebody. Think about divine things when it comes to helping somebody. Think about divine things when your brother needs a hand, you will be there to help him out. Think about divine things when it comes to not judging one another. Think about divine things when it comes to praying for one another. Think about divine things when it comes to holding to God's unchanging hands and not letting go. Think about divine things when it comes to interceding for somebody else who's going through such a hard time they can't even lift a prayer up for themselves. It is time for the church. It is time for people who claim to be the children of God to set their minds on heavenly things and act like people of heaven. Act like the residents of something divine. Act like the children of God. Act like the heirs of God and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. And the way you act like it is to begin to think like it. You got to think during this season of Lent right now, I'm a child of God. So I'm going to do what a child of God's going to do. I'm going to love. I'm going to pray. I'm going to serve. I'm going to forgive. I'm going to help. I'm going to sacrifice. I'm going to do missions. I'm going to do outreach. I'm going to lift up the name of Jesus. Even in the midst of a pandemic that says no, I'm going to let God's love and truth say yes. I'm going to fight racism and discrimination. I'm going to think like the people of God. My mind's going to be changed. My mind's going to be renewed. My mind's going to be transformed by the Spirit of God. And I'm going to walk with God in the color of royalty, because I'm going all the way by the power of Jesus Christ. And I'm not going to turn around for nothing in this world. Hallelujah. As I say that, I don't say that of my own strength, because of my own strength, I can't make it. Of my own strength, I will fail. But when the word of God transforms me, when the power of God makes me a brand new creature, when the love of Jesus Christ fills my heart, then I know I can make it, because there's nothing greater than his love. So if you want to observe a true Lenten season that is worthy of self-denial unto Jesus Christ, think heavenly, think divine. In the midst of a COVID-19 world, set your mind on heavenly things and be an agent of God's divine healing love during this season of Lent for such a time as this. Amen.
Thank you for worshiping with Mount Carmel today. We hope that you deeply felt our Lord's very presence throughout this service, and that you will carry his love with you from here and share it with others. We also hope that you will choose to continue worshiping with us in future weeks. We love being in community with you. We extend a special thank you today to all of you who faithfully support our various ministries through your gifts of time and treasure. We thank you sincerely for gifts of any size. Each and every contribution helps our parish continue vital ministries. To support our ministries with a financial gift, you may donate either through our website, hopemountcarmel.org, or by mailing your gift to 9411 Baltimore Road, Frederick, Maryland, 21704. You may also call our church office, 301-662-1303, or email our church administrator at donna.clausen@hopemountcarmel.org. If you would like further information about any of our ministries, or if you would like to speak to a pastor. Again, Thank you so much for worshiping with us today and for all the ways in which you contribute to God's kingdom. God bless you and keep you. All righty.